Welcome to the Eclecticist Podcast. Eclecticist is an investigation of everything from a British perspective by two brothers who consider themselves to be relatively normal chaps, one topic at a time. We are Benjamin de Campos, a designer and believer, and Jeffrey Campos, an engineer and a devil's advocate. We typically choose a topic of interest, we spend a little bit of time researching it and having a good think, then we have a discussion, and we publish the notes at the end. The benefit, generally, is the fostering of a greater understanding of the world. In general, one topic at a time, as I say, before we die, and hopefully we prompt further thought and discussion from our listeners. The topic that we will be discussing this episode is the music industry in general. Music is the art form most concerned with precision wobbling of the air in order to produce pleasing sounds. Since time immemorial, the motivations to achieve such auditory delights have included religious exultation, regal salutation, military motivation, sexual stratagem, social ascent, poetry, and whimsy. As with any human endeavor, over the course of time, an industry is formed through the natural selection of assembled componentry, codification, methodology, agreed nomenclature, commonality of goals, to name but a few. Music is one of the oldest common pursuits for which, arguably, the most conspicuous industry has arisen. Beautiful sound can transport us. Does knowledge of the machine behind the curtain spoil the magic? What we're not going to try and talk about are particular artists. We're not going to talk about unrelated topics like dark energy or Scientology. We're going to try and stick to the actual industry itself and how we perceive it, how we think it has changed, and how it affects us. Generally speaking, I think the popularity of music doesn't need to be mentioned. I think everybody automatically, universally thinks that music is fabulous and wonderful and everybody loves it.
I don't think that's true. I think there are a lot of people who don't give much of a darn for music. I'm getting sort of less and less fussed about music, really. I consider myself a musician of sorts. Music used to be something very close to me. I mean, it still is to a certain extent, but nowhere near as much. And I wonder whether or not it's a general cynicism or just finding other things more interesting to listen to.
Is it running out of time? You simply have too much to do and you have less time to spend on music? Or has it lost some of its magic?
I don't know, but there's something that you didn't mention there in the intro, which might be relevant, which is an artistic pursuit, music, you know, songwriters being artists, and how that plays into the whole industry side of things. Because I like bands or musicians who are clearly artists, and I'm less keen when I feel like I'm being manipulated in some way, because it's just music industry puppetry happening.
But where does the manipulation start? Does it not start with the artists? I mean, they're courting your attention because they either believe they have something to say, or they believe they have the wherewithal to affect you on some emotional level in order to provide themselves with validation or a sense of achievement. They're manipulating you. It's a manipulation game, surely.
I guess you could describe it that way, but I think not everyone who writes music or is somehow involved in the producing of music, I think not everyone is an artist, should I say? Maybe we need to unpack that a little bit more, what do you mean by artist?
I think
there's an enormous difference between bands. A band like Pink Floyd, for example, compare that to a band like, I don't know. What's a contemporary of Pink Floyd?
One Direction?
Yeah, I mean, that really is apples and sheds.
Well, I mean, they were designed, I suppose, taking those examples, One Direction is I believe, a manufactured pop band.
I doubt it's any other type of band.
A contemporary group of singers.
Yeah, you said band earlier.
Not band. Yeah. So they are the talent. That is to say, they have faces, they have personalities, and they have voices. and they sing songs that are written by other people, I believe. And the music is written by other people, and the music is played by other people.
It sounds like the definition of template-driven pop.
Well, they're a production. So, you know, they're designed and produced and delivered by committee.
Well, you see what I mean, but template-driven.
So, yeah, they are an industry. And they are very clearly targeting a particular market to try and maximize profits for the investors. Yes. Now, each member of One Direction, whom I have no familiarity with beyond the name, they could very well be extremely into music and, you know, totally epitomize a love of music. Perhaps, I don't know. But they have signed their names to a contract and they are part of the machine, effectively. They're a delivery mechanism for the music producers and the industry in order to try and cultivate the market and pull out as much money as possible. So what I'm trying to say here is that if they represent the music industry as a profit-maximizing business, Pink Floyd, on the other hand, were a group who set out to build music themselves. That is to say, they weren't after fame, per se. They thought they had something to say. They thought they could put pleasing music together, and they went out there to try and sell that idea to people with the same goal, generally speaking, that they want to garner as much attention from the public as possible. But are they that different? Or
yeah, absolutely.
They are. Absolutely.
Yeah, I mean,
not different in terms of are they good or bad?
No, I'm not saying that. I'm saying yes, they are completely different. Pink Floyd, you know, they knew each other, formed a band, they got signed. That right from the start is completely different from a band like One Direction, who are, you know, it was the idea of a record. I'm just guessing.
Oh, yeah, this is potentially this is a bad. A bad example, okay, because we both don't know anything about One Direction.
Well,
but I think One Direction...
We can make some safe assumptions,
yeah,
really.
I think so.
But it's, you know, record companies have ideas that they see what's popular, and they... Again, I'm going to say it again, it's template-driven. It's so formulaic. People audition, you know, people who look the part, who can sing, but they don't have to sing that well. And that's pretty much about it. And then the record company and all the other subsidiaries then go about manufacturing this product.
I mean, I think, well, there it is. It's a product. And I think if we follow the money and we think, okay, well, what is the goal exactly of the music industry? And the goal is to make as much money as possible for the investors, like any business. It's a profit-driven enterprise. So given the amount of technology available, given the decades of statistics and research that has been conducted and that is available, you're going to want to analyze precisely what it is that generates the maximum amount of money out of the market. So that has led, that has developed the templates and the formula. And this formula has given us these manufactured bands with high production values. And this is a phrase, production values. But, you know, every band, I say band, but every musical act that comes along is amazingly well-polished, I think.
Well, well-polished. But I think you can say well-polished, you can say empty, sterile, words like that. And I think when you just discussed this product and, you know, the goal is to make money, etc., that's... doesn't really sit in the same, I don't know, sentence as any kind of artistic pursuit. You know, with songs, they're, yeah.
Artistic integrity are you talking about?
Artistic integrity.
So an artist is someone, to define an artist, potentially in musical terms, is someone who believes that they have something to say which will benefit others.
Is that it could be
reasonable?
It could be someone who just feels he has something to say. Doesn't need to benefit others. Some people can be an artist and don't share anything with anyone. They just write something down and keep it in a drawer.
Because they like it. And then posthumously it could be discovered that it pleases other people.
It's an outlet, yeah. Absolutely. So that sort of... I can't think of the words, but... that seems pretty far removed from the boy band, or whatever they're called these days, which doesn't seem like there's anything like that. It's completely devoid of any kind of artistic expression.
Well, here's on the topic of why do people write music and how music is written, and I think a weird analogy would be, which just came into my mind, would be boxing versus wrestling.
Right.
Go with me on this. Okay. So in boxing, let's say you have two boxers and the goal is to win, to beat the other guy.
Mm.
And in boxing, you want to do that as quickly as possible to save yourself, you know, major injuries. Mm-hmm. So if you can just stride across the ring and lamp the other chap to the point where it's an immediate knockout and you've won the first 6 seconds of the of the game, you win. That's great. That's boxing. But in wrestling, in American character superhero wrestling, it's a show. They're putting on a show, and people come in and they pay for a show that lasts 2 hours, and they have to fill 2 hours with entertainment. It's not a case of winning. It's completely removed the competitive sport angle, and instead it's cabaret, it's theater. So it's kind of distorted the fundamental,
the purity,
the defining ethos of what sport is.
The purity of knocking someone cold.
It's an analogy. But what I mean is, it's kind of redefined the genre in order to pander to the viewer, to the person who is to be entertained. It wants to make it a little bit more predictable, but it wants to guarantee a certain amount of entertainment. So although you could have a boxing match, which is absolutely thrilling, and it can go to 15 rounds, and it's just the best boxing match you've ever seen, that's not necessarily controllable by the production team. It's just you're lucky if that happens. Because what could happen is it's an immediate knockout and game over. You've all paid your tickets, but it's time to go home now because it's over. But it's moving much more into the back room. The music industry is getting much more control, and it no longer really wants to rely on anybody's talent, and they don't want to be a slave to any particular genre or band or talent. They want total control. Not only do they want to completely control the acts that they're presenting, but they also want to have a large hand in the cultivation of the market itself. They want to be able to tell you what you like, and then give you exactly what it is they've just told you that you like. And the end result is you really like it.
I'm not sure.
And this is based on decades and decades and decades of such an ancient industry. They can do this.
Yeah, I'm not sure if that's such a useful analogy. Maybe you could say someone giving a reading in a room compared to Vegas or something like that. But I think those two situations just appeal to the different type of music fan. As in, you know, the boy band appeals to a certain demographic. Pink Floyd appealed to a completely different type of demographic.
With no overlap.
I don't think there's any overlap at all. I mean, they are so
worlds
opposite
apart.
Ends. I mean, I agree with what you're saying. I don't know, because, again, something like a boy band or those manufactured bands, I just don't think they... I think there are people who just won't get anything out of that kind of format of music.
Yeah, the people who are outside of the target audience. The target audience really is, like, 5 to 10-year-olds. And then anything beyond a 10-year-old is somebody who's...
A paedophile.
No, listening to the music and enjoying it for nostalgic reasons. You know, an 11-year-old might well listen to something like, you know, Take That and think, I remember when I was really into them.
11-year-old might say that?
Yes.
Right.
I mean, well, let's talk about songwriting.
Yes.
The actual process of songwriting itself. We've mentioned it's a committee.
Well, it can be. It's a committee.
It can be, but this is unfortunately not based on hard facts. But I get the general impression from everything that I read that usually there's more than one individual involved when writing a song these days for a major
band. Oh, you say these days?
Yeah, so, you know, a contemporary band now, One Direction, for instance.
It seems unlikely
that their songs are written by one member of the band.
I think what we should do is we should actually put this into categories. Because you've got bands, groups that are is cold, cynical, money-making machine. Money-making machine, like One Direction and that. Basically all pop. Everything you'd hear on Capitol. It comes out of that. And then you've got bands who have some kind of integrity. They might have been friends at school who put a band together. They might have, you know, played gigs. They might have got signed. But one of them is a songwriter. One member of the band is a songwriter. He has the vision. That's typically kind of how it works. You might come to the group with a sketch and they all work on the song together and it becomes, you know, credited to all of them. Blur, for example. You know, Damon Albarn writes all the songs. But all the songs are credited to Blur because, you know, they work together and they all contribute something. But Damon had the original idea. And then you've got, I don't know, maybe something that's more artistic but less commercial. And there's probably, I don't know, I can't name any of them, but I'm sure there are lots of bands that aren't particularly successful or popular or have any commercial success, but they might be signed to some kind of independent label. And they don't want to sell out, you know. They say no to the big tours or the big promotion or whatever because they feel that somehow tarnishes their integrity or gets in the way or something. They just don't want to compromise. Sid Barrett, for example, some people could argue that it wasn't him going mad as such, which I think it is.
He was pink.
It was that he just didn't want to be part of the machine and he just didn't want to whistle to their tune. And, you know, maybe there's that third category. So you might say that I'm unfairly boxing things up here, but that's kind of how I see it. And I just think there's no cross-contamination there.
But success seems to be the qualifier, because I can imagine every member of One Direction
think
they're a songwriter.
I think it's completely nonsense.
But they just haven't been successful as songwriters, therefore you don't see them as songwriters. But they could genuinely, all of them, could really thoroughly believe in what they're doing. It's just other people don't like what they do. So does that make them less an artist?
Again, I think a true artist wouldn't do what someone else told them to do. And
Well, that's not true. Lots of artists out there are simply forced to do what they're told to do, especially when you're in a constraining contract.
Prince,
for example.
No, I just don't think so. I think people who are actual songwriters would feel as they really are selling their soul to Satan in going on stage and doing what the boy bands do. I think there are people who are really good at that sort of thing. And
just to interrupt there, there's a film out at the moment called Inside Llewellyn Davis, I think. Is it Llewellyn Davis? And it's about a nearly famous singer-songwriter who is super mega talented, but he just simply, that talent is not recognized.
Right.
So he's forced to play the tune of his overlords. And the fact that he's immensely talented is simply lost. It's missed.
Right.
And perhaps that is the case with a lot of pop stars now.
You're really big on giving them the benefit of the doubt.
Well, I'm just saying, the industry, I think, has changed. And I think, you know, there were early, the pioneers potentially mined all the gold away and there's no more gold to get. You know, the bands these days have such a steep climb, they can't deliver anything that's interesting or innovative because it's all been done. We've had so many genres of music and we're all so saturated with the influence from all the different genres of music. How can you possibly hope to be original or innovative or deliver anything that's really different?
Okay, well,
it's all gone. It's been used up.
Well, I mean,
people who perhaps never deserved it.
Hang on, do you actually believe that, what you just said?
Well, that there's no more gold in the hills?
Yeah. Before you say anything, every podcast at the end you say, oh, this is some open source music here that I really like, and you play a tune.
Yeah, I haven't said that I believe that yet. I'm definitely a believer in, I mean, as a futurist, generally speaking, I think, yeah, there's a huge amount of innovation out there. And as you know, I'm much more into more contemporary musical styles. I was always into contemporary classical music. And then I discovered dubstep, which is exactly what I was looking for with contemporary classical music, in that it's an extremely pleasing and exhilarating sound. And there are no barriers or formulas or anything. It can do anything. It's just sound. So I think we have a long way to go before we've exhausted everything. But I still think young people especially, they're kind of overwhelmed by the very immediately available history of music. And their thinking is forced into on a rail. And to escape that rail and do something different is getting increasingly difficult, I think. For example, this new chap who evidently is the next big thing, Sam Shepard, I think his name is. He was on Radio 4 the other day. And he's very talented. He's featured on a lot of singles by other performers and artists. But now he's going solo. And he has a fabulous voice. He sounds great. He seems to make a lot of sense. And he's very aware of the music industry. And I mean, one of his songs is all about the pressure that is on him to deliver, to make money. He needs to generate a hell of a lot of money to pay all of the careers that are hanging off of his success.
That's right.
And he feels that. So he's working for his team, you know, his company. And how does that affect artistic integrity, and how does that affect the quality of the music? When you're simply forced to write an album or forced to write a song, you're pushed into a room.
Was he complaining?
No, he wasn't complaining. He was just saying how it is. He said, you know, there's a lot of pressure on me now, and I need you to buy my songs. And these are the lyrics in the song, I kid you not. And I think, well, he's very honest, and he comes across as somebody who, you know, has been heavily affected by the machine, but also has a deep love of music and has a very definite talent. I mean, he definitely is extremely talented. I heard him singing. I thought, wow, I want to hear more from this guy. He sounds great. But again, the size of the industry and the expectations that are piled on the backs of people who are signed to a record label and how binding these contracts are, which I don't know, but presumably I can imagine
that. Well, it's very well known. You hear these stories all the time. All the parasites. There's so many real bands have either wrote albums about this sort of thing or spoken about it at length. We were talking earlier about George Michael. He was a young kid, and I think he's a good songwriter. He's not my cup of tea, but I can respect that he's a songwriter, good performer, good singer, and all that. And he just signed his life away at such an early age and suffered like hell because of it. Because he was so young as well, the music industry is not real life. It messes with your brain. He goes totally crazy. Prince has got a similar story about how he had this contract that he couldn't get out of. Michael Jackson. Everyone, basically.
Yeah, no, indeed. I mean, you think it's... it's Faustian when you think about the actual contracts that people are signing. You can imagine it's in blood, and you can imagine it's, you know, 90% of everything you ever make belongs to us forever.
Muhahaha. Yeah, it's bizarre because, I mean, we don't really think about it, but these people, they're human beings. And we don't see them as human beings. And
they're fair game.
They're vulnerable, and their egos are extremely delicate because they don't know what to think or do. They've got people screaming, you know, at them, adulation, start to believe they're gods. things don't go their way, they explode. It's just absolutely bizarre.
And they trash their hotel rooms.
It is indeed. Actually, I should say that of all the stories of rock star whingers complaining at us and how we should be apologizing for making them so rich, the only one that ever holds any water with me is the Roger Waters of Pink Floyd again. It was his album, The Wall. I think he speaks in that piece of art very eloquently and beautifully about the true trappings of the music industry, the pressures, the fame, the everything that leads to everything that's bad, all the parasites.
Yeah, it's Aladdin's lamp. I mean, you know, there are costs.
But clearly, with every popular performer, there's these compromises, I think, that they have to make. What's that line of the Pink Floyd song? A walk on part in a war? Would you... I can't remember. But anyway,
it sounds familiar. I can hear the music when you say that. Anyway. But I just remind everybody, we're listening to... you are listening to eclecticist.co.uk. This is a podcast that we try and deliver as frequently as possible, and it's about absolutely everything. It's completely eclectic. The clue is in the title. And if you'd like to access some of our previous programming or leave us, say, a message or a suggestion for a future topic, just visit eclecticist.co.uk. You can figure out how to spell that. And just click on the contact form and drop us a note and give us some suggestions for future shows. That would be wonderful.
Maybe drop us an actual note. Maybe send us a letter.
Actually send us a letter through the post. That would be fantastic. And make sure you've covered the amount that it costs. Yes. We don't have.
And make sure you mark the envelope to this address.
And if you send a stamped self-addressed envelope, we'll send a podcast back to you. About the stakeholders and investors in music. I mean, again, I don't know anything about this, but I can imagine somebody in the music industry would have a portfolio and they would have a card or a folder of a band. And this would be the product that they are offering to investors. And they would have to sell it.
Mm.
They would say, this young man, Bob Wilkins, has a really soulful voice and he has a great potential and a great future. And his target market is very well defined. And historically, this particular genre pays very well for these types of media. And his particular target market is also interested in this, this, and this product. So you can cross merchandise. And we believe that this is an excellent investment opportunity. And we're aiming to raise this much money in order to promote him in this particular way, and we're confident that he'll reach this, this, and this. So investors will look at that because they're sitting on a huge, you know, hedge fund operators are sitting on a whole bunch of money that a whole bunch of people have given them, that they have convinced to give them, and they're looking for an investment vehicle. So they'll be presented with this product, which is a human or a group of humans, and they'll think, okay, well, what will be the return on my investment? Will it be enough to convince the bank to give me more money that I can invest in other things? It's a commodity. It's a total commoditization of these people's talent, or, you know, they're like football players. Mm. So they have a very short lifespan, but they have a potential to earn an awful lot of money. And if they sign on the right dotted line, most of the money that they generate will go into the initial investment. So who are the investors? I mean, they're going to be hedge fund operators. They're going to be, I mean, I suppose there could be benefactors. There could be people who think, you know, I really believe in that young man. I think he's extremely talented and I'm going to invest money in him with a low level of return purely because I want to see him go far. Now, how much does that help or affect the music landscape in general? So, I mean, if you have a mediocre band, let me think of one, on the tip of my mind. They were huge in the 80s and early 90s, and they had a massive cash injection because their record label ran out of all their other acts. REM. That's it.
Yeah, you can't compare REM with any of the bands you're talking about.
Hideously and well invested in. And I think, did they really deserve all of that promotion?
Yeah, again, it's REM are just not that kind of band that you could talk about like that. They are a band, you know, Michael Stipe, the singer-songwriter, is a real delicate, artistic type of man. And they had a big following. A lot of people really liked them. And, they became a part of the major label machine. But I don't know. It just seems wrong to talk about bands like REM and talk about bands like One Direction. They're just two completely different products.
Well, no, they are different products, but they're products in the same
sector. Okay, I'll tell you why they're different. I'll tell you why they're different. With REM, if an album performs badly, then you could say, okay, they wrote some crap songs, they used the wrong producer who didn't get the best out of them, etc. But with One Direction, you can't say anything about them. You have to say, oh, this group of faceless songwriters didn't quite deliver, and Pro Tools broke down or whatever. It's that you're comparing, I don't know.
Yeah, but the actual band members of One Direction are an incredibly and critical part of the production.
Are they?
I mean,
are they though?
They're 100%. They are necessary, but not. They are essential and necessary, but not capable on their own. They need their massive flotilla of production agents.
Okay, but they are, each member, I mean, you know, I don't know them, but I'm guessing that they are more performers. They are show people.
They're at the front end. They are the user interface.
I think it would be disingenuous to call them musicians.
Well, I don't think they call themselves music. Well, perhaps they would. Well, but I agree. I don't think you'd call them musicians.
If they're not musicians and it's a pop group, then what the hell are they then?
It's a production. It's like, well, that's like saying, you know, dancer number 6 in this musical production, this stage musical. Well, what hell part are they? Well, they're just part of the act. They are part of the act.
I think everything reduces down. Well, in my case, really, because I've got no attention span for anything, and it just reduces down to, you know, does it move you? And there are certain REM songs that I can listen to, and I think, oh, that's quite good. That's quite like that bit. It's quite powerful. We like that little sentiment there. But I just walk right past anything I hear on Capital FM because it's nonsense. It's template driven pop. I said that about 4 times now. It's exactly what
it is. It's true, but obviously there is a target market.
Yeah, kids.
Yeah. And some kids.
No, it's kids or people who don't really like music very much or it's not really a big part of their lives.
Indeed. I think so. I mean, I suppose so. I mean, I don't know any One Direction songs, but I can imagine One Direction has a song which is catchy or it's
completely derivative.
Well, isn't everything?
Yeah.
But
everything in that genre is.
But, you know, they could put something together really well and it's really tight and it really works and it's fun and you don't mind hearing it.
Right.
Many times you don't mind hearing it. Whereas something, I guess, a little deeper or a little bit more involving, a little bit more thoughtful and thought-inspiring, perhaps it's a little too heavy and muddy, and generally you're not generally...
For you.
You're not generally in the mood to listen to it all the time.
No, but any of that... Again, this is just so subjective. Any of that flavour of pop, any modern pop, basically, I cannot listen to. It's not a case of I can just have it in the background. I cannot listen to any of that stuff. The radio at work that the stations, you know, flick about, and just the difference of going to Capital, say, from Six Music. Six Music, there's 2 contemporary music stations. You know, Six Music play music by bands, and Capital, for example, don't.
Well, my experience of those 2 stations, which is extremely limited because I don't listen to any music at all, but... I just before Christmas, I was listening to Capital FM,
right,
and they were playing music, and I just had to switch it over. I knew I had to switch it over to another music station, but I just couldn't stand Capital because it's just awful. So I put it on the only other music station that I think could be better than Capital FM and all the other commercial garbage, and that was Six Music. And I popped it on Six Music, and it was some chap who I couldn't stand, but at least he was talking about a song and the performer and educating me about the song, the process of writing the song and the performer, what they were doing at the time when they wrote the song, what it was really about. And it was educational.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, well, you know, they're playing the music, which I don't particularly like, but they're talking about the music and being interesting about the music.
Yes.
I thought, well, that's a million times more valuable than
I'm happy to hear the commercial treadmill.
And I just thought, oh, you know, there's so much more out there. But again, lots of people don't want all of that.
Yes,
like, it's not
true.
That important to them. And they just like a nice, happy, bouncy beat while they're doing whatever it is they're doing.
That's completely true.
And that's true. So muzak versus music, I suppose. So there are genres, there are target markets, there are audiences. I personally think the audiences are getting younger and younger and younger. The target markets are children because
they have money.
The music industry is after disposable money, so it's going to have to, it's being forced down, I suppose. And I guess it's a race to the bottom in possibly every kind of way, and that's just the way it is. And I think the investors who are investing in these bands, they know this, and I don't know, it feels to me like it's increasingly desperate, despite the fact that I always get the impression everybody thinks music is fabulous. I was listening to the radio just now, and they were talking about it was some comedy program, Mark Steele.
Mark Steele. And he was just on today.
I know, I was listening to it, and he was in Derry.
He's in Londonderry.
Yeah, and he was going on about how, you know, the music scene is really fabulous in Derry, and, you know, everybody loves music, so, you know.
The undertones.
And I just thought, does everybody love music? And I suppose they do.
No, they don't.
Music can transport you. I've always believed this. A really good piece of music is amazing.
Can transport.
Then again, a really good bit of cheese is amazing.
I agree. Music can transport me. There are bands that, or music, you know, I'm a fan of all different flavors, classical music. Certain combination of chords can really evoke an emotional response. This is well known, but I also think that there are people who are immune to that. Our mother, for example,
it's just an irritation. But music can be fabulously irritating.
That might not actually be that true, but it certainly appeared to not mean as much to her than, say, me. But there are people who just don't, like Sam Harris is a good friend of mine. He was talking on the radio and he said, he was talking about, what we're missing. And he says, I'm not really good with music, but I can recognize that there's something really great there that I'm missing. I can't remember what that was for, but he's someone else who maybe is not crazy about music.
I don't think I'm crazy about music. I mean, it's one of those things where I'd like to be, but I just really, I can quite easily not listen to music. I mean, I'd much rather read a book than listen to any kind of music. And the reason for that, I think, is, I mean, I have a very short attention span, for sure. And if I'm listening to music, it can very quickly become irritating. And I'm really trying to make a move towards listening to more music.
This is going against everything you've just said.
I'm really trying to listen to more music because I think it is important.
Right.
You know, time, we're all time impoverished. And I think there's so many other things I think I should be doing rather than listen to music, which I think is completely passive. But enjoyable. But I think, I guess I've become greatly cynical with music, and I think I believe everybody who is producing music and playing music at me is doing so for the fame, for the money, for the gratification that they're able to affect another person. They're doing it because they're seeking attention. They think they're special. They think they're wonderful, and they need somebody to pat them on the back for it.
That's one hell of a generalization.
I think that's a personal motivation, I can't even say the word, motivation for producing music personally. I think you want the fame. I don't believe there's anybody sitting in a room composing music and thinking, God, this is absolutely fabulous. And then I'll just put that in the drawer and I don't really want anybody else to know about it.
Right.
I'd never know about it, but I don't think there is anybody doing that. Because I think the desire to make music and to play music and to present music is ordered for other people. I mean, if you were the only person on the planet, if any musician was the only person on the planet, I think, you know, they wouldn't really produce any music.
I completely disagree with you. I think that seems a very binary way of thinking just then. I mean, there are degrees to all of this stuff. I mean, to a certain extent, I write music and I don't do anything with it. You know, what am I going to do? I'm not going to become any kind of rock star, but I still write little tunes. I don't do it for fame. I don't do it for attention. I don't show that to anyone. And I'm sure there's lots of people like me.
I don't believe you. Moving on to the actual cultivation of the market itself. I've mentioned this earlier. I believe that every mature business gets to the point where they're able to, or at least aspire to, cultivate their own market. They want more and more and more people to buy their product. And if they can affect that market in order to produce more subscribers to their services or buyers of their products, they'll do it. And I think the music industry is old to the point where this happens almost by reflex. And I think the music industry has a great influence on the media. And through the media, they influence especially the young and push them in the directions of their products. Do you agree with this? I think, for instance, you know, the music review magazines and the classic ones like NME, all of these publications which review music, and they basically give music, or any media really, but music, a rating. You know, how this is a really fabulous album. It's really absolutely brilliant. It completely blew me away. I couldn't believe how excellent this music was. You should go and buy it. It's available here for $12.99.
Click here
to buy now.
We covered this in our professional critics podcast. That type of thing.
Yeah, so the music industry cultivates their market. I mean, one of your
absolutely.
Yeah, I think so. I think, and they're very good at it, and they can do it in a variety of different ways. They can, you know, put their band members on reality TV programs into soap operas.
You know what? There must be more people like me out there. Maybe there isn't. My solipsism is surfacing. I'm so bored of this kind of thing. I mean, you said this earlier, is all these people thinking they're doing something for the first time. It's like, okay, well, you're not.
Well, that's always tedious.
Yeah, but it's just also the feeling I'm being manipulated. And in order to avoid that, I just don't even bother with any of the things I used to read, like The Enemy, any of that lot. And I find Six Music radio station, though I have a lot of problems with it, particularly just DJs who think they're funny is my main issue. But that is definitely the best of a bad bunch, I think, in terms of them being, as you say, them being more interested in the music. And that is like a little hand out of the bubble for me. I can actually listen to Six Music and feel like I'm not having to swallow all the crap with them, you know, spoon feed me diarrhea. But I don't know. Yeah, I mean, I don't have the bands that we talk about, or like
One Direction.
I don't even know what they look like, and I'm so happy about that.
They probably have really smiley, shiny faces. And there's probably one member who's really tattooed.
They've probably got floppy hair.
Yeah, probably.
And say, girl.
And they sing about babies in every single song.
Yeah. And have that weird new sound that's been a few years now. It's like, when they're singing, it's this weird auto-tuned noise. You know what I'm talking about.
I'm trying to. I know the falsetto trick. I know a lot of them pull that one.
Right.
And the auto tunes and all the technology. Of course, there's all the technology. I mean, it really doesn't matter if you're not a particularly good singer. It doesn't really matter.
Well, that's the point I was making earlier.
You don't need talent in that direction any longer, I don't think.
Well, should we, speaking of talent, you had something there about comparing a songwriting... what's it called? It was Beyonce. Actually, Beyonce's pretty old school these days, because she's from the 90s.
Yes. Yeah, I never rated her at all. I thought she couldn't dance. I thought...
She ugly?
No, I don't really...
I thought that's where you were going.
She's completely forgettable looking. I mean, I can't remember what she looks like. She looks fairly generic.
There's a big photograph in front of you.
There is, but I mean, she looks just... She looks generic. I'll forget her as soon as I look away.
Actually, I think...
And dancing, I think... I thought she was a natural dancer, like Madonna. Madonna could never
really
dance.
Let me stop you there. I have to say...
Or sing, for that matter.
I saw Beyonce Knowles... I think it's her little sister, maybe? Couldn't be her little sister, I'm not sure. Anyway, we went to some music festival in the summer, and her sister came out and played some music, and it was totally appropriate to a festival crowd. You know, festival crowd, were there to see bands, groups, actual bands. But Beyonce Knowles' sister, I think it was her, I can't remember her name. And it was fine. It was like, wow, that's kind of different from the usual pap pop.
Of course, originally festivals were places you would go to discover completely new bands. But now it seems to be a place where you go to just listen to the music you've already heard from bands you already know.
Yeah, maybe. I mean, well, that's not strictly true, because festivals have lots of bands, and it's not likely that I'm going to be familiar with all the bands playing. I might hear something and think, oh, that's kind of good. You have to watch out for them.
Mm. Yes, the market cultivation and the media saturation, and you know, it's just so predictable when new bands are promoted, and it's like book tours. You know, you only ever hear from somebody when they're trying to sell you something. You think, he must have a book out, he must be trying to sell something, why is he on this program, he's trying to sell something.
Hey, there's actually probably an analogy there with authors, writers I should say, because you know, if you're at any bookstore, you look across the bestseller list or whatever, there's a whole load of books written by people that you wouldn't thought are writers or authors even.
lots of autobiographies by
David Jason.
Well, that's fine. David Jason is a man in his 60s that has been around,
you know, since Danger Mouse.
Since Danger Mouse. So he's got a lot to say, and I'm sure he would have some interesting anecdotes. But I'm talking more of the sort of ghost-written autobiographies from people who are 18. You know, how much really do they have to say about anything? And you could argue that ghost-written, template-driven books, they know exactly the type of people that would buy them. There you go. And I don't see it as any kind of outlet for the author. It's not like they had this book inside of them. Go on.
But isn't it just a fractionation of a particular genre? So, for instance, you know, you originally probably had music, and music was just hitting a femur on a rock.
Mm.
And then, you know, maybe you had a different type of bone, or you had a leaf or something. And then suddenly you have two different genres of music available to you. And now you have different genres of pop music. You have music that does adhere to a very strict template or formula. Mm. But it's a formula you like. It's like going, it's like if you like Big Macs, you know, you can go to any Big Mac in the, any McDonald's in the country and buy a Big Mac. And it's identical to the last Big Mac you had in any other McDonald's.
Mm-hmm.
There are lots of other restaurants that you could choose from in the high street, but you always go back to McDonald's because it's predictable.
Mm.
It's your choice is safe in that you know you're going to get what you like.
Mm.
You don't have to take the risk on something else, which could be a lot better. But then again, it could be lot worse.
Again, there are lots of different types of people in the world. There are people like that, and there are people who aren't like that. And I'm really glad there are people not like that, because they tend to be people that I'm interested in speaking to.
But are there people not like that any longer? Surely everybody is resistant to change and are more likely to follow the predictable path. This is what I'm saying. Innovation and just change is just bleeding away.
I've just been saying that I'm not one of these people. And surely there must be other people like that.
No, well, I didn't think so. I'm glad you agree.
I've certainly, well, again, I don't know what you're really driving at there. I'm telling you that bands like One Direction, I'm just not, I'm not in the place where they play. I'm not near the radio stations that they're on. I don't watch television. I don't read newspapers. So I don't see them.
You barely step out of the house.
No, but I'm sure that sort of cynicism must be wide rife.
I think so. But then again, I mean, perhaps there was a time when music or the music industry, in its most cynical form, would try and target the widest possible market.
Mm.
But now the market is so large, perhaps, that they're trying to target a very, very small, specific target market. One Direction is probably targeted at 11-year-old ginger girls with, you know, a Barbie fixation. Such a tiny slice of the market is enough for the investors in that band, and they just focus, laser focus on a very small segment of the market. They're not interested in you or 12-year-old girls or 9-year-old girls. They don't care.
That's interesting that you speak like that, quite confidently, that 11-year-old gingerhead
12-year-old gingerheads.
You said 11.
Did I?
How do these companies make their money? Exactly. Because we spoke earlier about, well, maybe I wasn't speaking to you about it, but it's like, for example, you know, you can't buy singles anymore, can you? How do record companies make their money?
That's an excellent question. I think, well, remember, they're selling something that is unlimited. They're selling an unlimited resource. That is to say, if I were selling gold coins, I only have a certain amount of gold coins. Until I were completely run out of gold coins, I need to go and find some more. So I'm selling a limited resource. Whereas music, you know, you're selling effectively rights to an unlimited resource. So, you know, you can walk through the door and say, I'd like to buy this album, please. All right, there you go. 50 trillion other people can come in and buy the same album. No problem. It's just more money for me. And it's limited by popularity. Like anything, like chocolate bars. When chocolate bar manufacturers say, you know, a limited edition Kit Kat. Well, yeah, it's limited to its popularity. If it was furiously popular, it would suddenly become unlimited and you'd never not be able to buy them.
I'm not sure if I really agree with that.
So it's what I'm saying is that, you know, especially in our digital age, it costs nothing to copy anything and it doesn't deprive anybody of anything. It only deprives the seller of a sale.
Where I thought you were going was in, it's not all about buying the music anymore. You've got 50 million different companies who have license to have the One Direction boys' faces on their products, like, you know, all the merchandise.
Well, exactly. It's no DVDs. Longer. It's no longer.
I think they've got a film out. Actually.
Yeah, it's no longer just selling a single. Now, of course, you have cross pollination as far as exposure is concerned, and there are a million different products. You know, from bobbleheads on the end of your pencil to posters and sneakers, and you know, this was pioneered decades ago, you know, the idea of merchandising and making most of your money not from the music, but all the crap that you can sell along on the fame.
You know what? I think it's more...
And all of that's factored in, of course.
I think it's just times are so different now because everything's about an experience now, and I think it's not a case of listening to them. You watch stuff online, you know, the YouTube channel for One Direction has probably got way more views than units they've sold.
Well, a lot more.
So
a lot
it's
more
all
is
from advertising.
Yeah, a lot more is taken into consideration as well. A lot more is important, I think, from performers, and I think it increases the stress and the pressure on performers because, for instance, in classical music is amazing in that whenever you, I mean, you just have to browse the CDs in the classical music section of any music store. They still exist, and you'll see the covers always have just, you know, either complete babes or, you know, fairly young, black-haired studs on the front playing all the music, and you think, is it really necessary for classical music performers to all be gorgeous? And yet, they appear to be. Just look up at random any contemporary, as in now, classical music performers, and they just happen to be gorgeous. Mm. All of them, almost without exception. It is bizarre.
Well, I don't know.
And I think the reason why is because that is a significant criterion. And also, Beyonce, I think there was an interview in the New York Times I read a couple of months ago about how she says, look, it's all about videos now. Mm. Her latest album is just, it's just all videos.
Mm.
And that's the way it is. And yes. Soon, of course, I can imagine performers will be releasing their music on YouTube.
Well, that's what I was just saying.
Yeah, and it'll be, you know, it is a big package. It's a production. It's theater. It's no longer a song. It's an entire, as you say, experience.
Mm.
And it has to have smell and sound and visuals and absolutely everything. You know, if my keyboard isn't electrocuting me over watching the latest video, well then, you know, it's wanting in some way.
Mm.
Just a melody is no longer it. And yet I think it is. A good melody is a good melody. There's no escaping the fact. There's no escaping talent. Talent may not necessarily rise to the top any longer. But I think it is still conspicuous to the point where it gets a lot of attention. Mm. Like, for instance, I was listening to Adele the other day.
Right.
Adele is British, I believe. Pretty young performer. I think she's a fantastic voice. Absolutely fabulous voice. And that shines through to a certain extent, even though I think a lot of what she does is quite derivative. And it's very commercial, but she just has a you know, an excellent voice. And for me, I really like excellent voices. Mm. If I hear somebody with an excellent voice, Pink, for instance, her music, I no major fan of, and I don't like the direction that she's gone in. I think, oh God. And whenever I hear her speak, it's just, oh no. But I think she has an amazingly good, very well controlled voice. I really like the sound of her voice when she's singing. That's just me.
I'm sure a lot of other people agree
with
you.
Yeah, and everybody thinks that sort of way about everybody. So, you know, there's always something about somebody that does something for someone, if you know what I mean.
Right.
And especially when much more is in consideration, the video and everything else. Well, then people will like a particular performer for a particular reason, and that particular reason may not actually be for the music.
Mm.
Justin Timberlake, he's done very well from his looks alone. He has an entire fan base who just like his movies. And don't know anything about his music.
He owns MySpace.
He is a product. And he knows he's a product. He promotes himself as a product. Everybody else promotes himself as a product. And he does very well.
That's fine. But it's just, you know,
he plays the game.
People who are really into that guy's music are
people I tend to not really have much contact with.
No, indeed. But moving on to technology. We mentioned technology earlier, and it has come an awful long way. I mean, it really has. It started out, it was originally non-existent, of course. And then it moved into the technology of the actual instruments themselves.
Mm.
And then, I suppose, the technology of process, and that is the technology of training and musical training and voice coaching and all the rest of it. And then, of course, there's the digital revolution. Well, there's the analog technological revolution before the digital revolution. But now, of course, you have Photoshop for sound. You can auto-tune people's voices. You can... There are tools available that allow you to compose music extremely rapidly. Rapid musical development systems that, you know, you can write and print playable music. I mean, I was reading an article about the chap from Radiohead who wrote a classical score.
Well, that's different, though.
Premiered at the St. Martin in the Fields, my favorite venue.
Johnny Green.
But he used a computer program, which it wasn't Sibelius.
It's just that
you know, he could literally write the music on his computer. Real time, writing, notes, hit enter, and it prints out to the point where somebody, a classical violinist, can just immediately start playing it. I mean, just that alone is, this is amazing technology. You can write a score or hum a tune and it automatically prints out the notes on the page. This helps. And perhaps, and I think we touched on this sort of idea in our car design podcast, whereby the technology has come along to the point where the real vision of the designers of the music can come closer to fruition. They were unable to do what they really thought they wanted to do in the past, but now they're closer to having the tools to do it. So any idea you have now, you're more likely to bring it into realization.
I think that's true, to a large extent, for artists who are able to get their ideas down. Like before, it used to be a quick sketch. And it's as though this is no longer a sketch. It's a finished oil painting that they can do.
I just sketched this oil painting on the back
of the envelope. Exactly that. I mean, my experience of this, being a musician of sorts and being in bands, back in the day, we used to record everything on cassettes.
What now?
Yeah, on cassettes and overdub other guitar parts or whatever. And it was a very laborious... process, and it used to sound crap, and it was just so much energy was burnt in just actually just recording stuff. Whereas now with GarageBand,
I actually have a couple of CDs of your music here. I'll put one on.
Maybe that should be the outro music. But with GarageBand, for example, it's just so easy, so much so that I think maybe artists wouldn't even think about then the technical side of it, and they just want to get stuff down. The demos that they're now producing are like finished.
Well, they want to be as prolific as possible. They just want a huge, massive list of songs that they've produced. Like, that's important.
I don't get you.
Well, what I mean is that just volume. They want to be able to say, I have 10 albums. I have 500 songs. They're all crap, but at least I have 500 songs.
I just knock
them out in the hopes that maybe one is good.
No, I don't agree with that. But I think it's certainly a case where people are
What I'm saying here is that I don't think people necessarily have the pressure or the desire to spend, like Flaubert, who famously said, you know, one of his contemporaries said, so what did you do today? You know, what did you do in your entire day? Oh, well, you know, I worked. I did a huge amount of work. And his friend looked at what he'd done, and he'd written one word. And he said, you've written one word. And he goes, yeah, but it's the right word. And I don't think people are bleeding over a particular song any longer. I think they just want to fill an album. They just want filler. They just want to
fill everything up. A lot of assumptions there.
Such a formula now. You have an album with 13 songs, and that's it. No deviation.
I don't think that's true. I think, you know, filler is filler. You know, you can't just come up with a song that's going to change someone's life or an album that's going to change someone's life overnight. You know, I think these artists do exist, and they don't just churn stuff out.
I think there are artists out there who do want to put together a collection of songs, but they want to put together a collection of songs in a derivative kind of way. And they're on rails.
Who are you talking about?
Anyone. anyone is on rails to they want to fill a this CD.
It's so full of sweeping generalizations.
I think that's reasonable. Can you think of anybody who doesn't have the concept of songs and who isn't creating a little self-encapsulated bubble of music, a song, and that's the subset, the standard discrete package of sound that any artist creates these days. Everybody thinks in terms of a song and a number of songs in a group of songs called an album. Who does any kind of anything else?
I'm not sure. Is there anybody?
Well, what I'm saying is that we all have a preconceived notion of what music is and how to present it to other people and how to produce it. I think we're all derivative. We have the weight of the history of music on our shoulders.
I can pick so
and
much.
We believe that there is a definition of music and that we have to adhere to that. We have all the genres and we feel as though we're falling into a particular category of music because that's what we like and that's what we're inspired by. I mean, I think I'd like to think that there's some way out of this and there's, but I don't know, it's just the creation of new genres perhaps. Like I like dubstep, but yeah, dubstep is now a formulaic genre of music. Mm. It's no longer as outrageous and offensive as it might have been a few years ago.
Mm.
But I mean, that, again, I guess that's the evolution of music and it just stumbles forward and moves slightly and technology helps it along a bit, I suppose. But it's hard because I can imagine having to write a song or being a songwriter because you have this ridiculous and very accessible music catalog of the last 100 years behind you. And you think, well, you know, I remember an interview with the makers of South Park and they were talking about their writing process and how they develop their episodes and they would think of an idea and they'd think, hey, God, that's brilliant. And then they'd look at the Simpsons back catalog and say, well, they've done it. That was a Simpsons episode. Damn, another brilliant idea that's, you know, somebody has stolen from us retroactively. I think the music industry has moved into the point where it's so derivative and so generic yet specific that they have to compensate for the fact that they have lost all innovation by cultivating the market and trying to convince people that it's actually really good. Their product's brilliant. They're like the emperor with no clothes.
Mm. Yeah.
Which is an analogy I'd love to build on, but I just...
But it's, again, you keep... I'm not sure what the correct fallacy is that you keep making. It's very binary what you're saying. If you listen back to what you've just said, because you keep putting like all music makers in this one box.
I see how you have gotten that impression.
Right.
And I think because that's the impression that I've been...
Yes, it is. I got that from the words you've been using.
The words that have been coming out of my mouth, I can imagine. Yeah, that's exactly where I was going with that. But there are... I mean, I think if there are musical talents out there who are producing something really original or really new or really different, I don't think the music industry would be interested in them until
the music
they
industry
are,
is
if
so
you know what
vast.
I mean.
I think you're talking about like major labels, but there's 50 million independent labels.
I mean, as you know, I'm thoroughly enjoying the Google Play Music subscription where they have like literally 3 million songs and they add tens of thousands of tracks every week.
Mm.
And you can just noodle your way through millions of genres and all kinds of obscurity and listen to crazy stuff. And I do this. And I do hear great music. I mean, I'm astounded at almost everything that I play, especially the newer music, how good it all is.
Mm.
It is good. You can't fault it, really.
Mm.
Does it move me emotionally? Well, that's rare in any case. But it is all very good. These are all very talented people. There's a lot of talent out there, huge amount of talent out there. And it's a real industry and it's a real skill now and people can really do it. And I think, well, have we exhausted it? I keep thinking, well, has the magic gone? We're all so familiar with the way it all works and what it's all for and how it's all done and what's out there and what's available and what has been done.
Mm.
I think perhaps we've all just become so cynical. We've lost our childish wonder at the magic of music, I think, a little bit. It's a fear of mine, I don't know. And perhaps it's not true.
Yes. I think it's... I'm certainly not listening to any new music these days. I'm discovering lots of old bands. I've just recently come to the conclusion that the Beatles really weren't the best band of the 60s, but yet the Beatles seem to manage to grab that place as like the best band of the 60s or whatever.
There was a
marketing, I don't know for what reason.
There was a chap on the radio yesterday who was a member or composer for the Ruttles, and he was talking
Eric
about...
Eric Idle? Was it, Ruttles is like
it's
a...
Like the sixth, it was the sixth Python, I think.
Ruffles is a Beatles parody.
Sort of, well, it's kind of a tribute band, really.
They didn't play any Beatles songs.
No, I know, but they're a tribute in that they're a tribute to the writing talent of the Beatles. So he said, this chap.
I guess.
He was just saying that he really rated their songwriting. He just thought they were outstanding. But he also said that they were derivative. You know, they were inspired by all the best music that was available to them at the time. Which is true, I guess, of anyone. You're going to be inspired by the music that you think is absolutely fabulous. Yeah, and the music yeah. that they thought was absolutely fabulous was a consensus the best songs
well,
that were available.
I think you're inspired by stuff and you build on it. And I think that's what they did.
Yeah, it's cause and effect. We can't escape it.
Yeah, anyway.
But moving on to the future of music, our final little topic in this discussion. What's going to happen? How is it all going to pan out? Are we all going to just fall at the feet of Robbie Williams and apotheosize him to Elvis proportions? Or are we all going to turn music into a cottage industry and produce it ourselves?
I don't know about we. This is the thing. I think maybe it'll be get more and more splintered. There'll be more of a divide between pap pop and bands with real integrity. Possibly. I don't know. I mean, it's... Again, it's hard for me to say because I feel so removed from it. That's not to say I don't see bands. I don't see actual live bands and think, wow, that's really great because I saw a fantastic band last week, in fact. You know, live music is still a real killer. And I think, again, another difference between the pop and a band is performance, live performance. When these bands, these One Directions, when they play live, it's like, really?
Well, it's a show.
Yeah, but what I mean is that...
That's what they do best.
A lot of enjoyment of a live band, I see, is when you're actually watching them do what they do best. And I don't think there are any actual sort of instruments being played in any of the manufactured bands when they're on stage. I think it's all on a hard drive, in fact.
Oh, I don't think so.
I do.
Okay. But I think, you know, easily One Direction can have a real band. I mean, you know, real bands are 10 a penny.
No, I don't think so.
They can easily have a real band behind
them. No, it's just not. The music is so sort of rigid and tight. It doesn't really allow for the space that there is inside of a band, a group producing sounds. Like,
now, there are lots of bands I've heard which I always thought were just computers playing and drum machines and everything. It actually turned out, no, they actually played all of the music. Similarly, like Apple website. If you go to Apple website, all of those beautiful computer renders of all their products, they're not. They're all photographs.
Yeah, I know this.
Yeah, they photograph everything. They do it in a weird kind of way, but they do photograph all of their products, and that was surprising. And
a lot of
these bands you think are all synthesizers and computers, actually, no. It turned out that it was more efficient for them to actually use real bands.
But there's nothing wrong necessarily with synthesizers and computers.
Well, certainly not.
I just think it's a difference between a band that can play live and a studio, a band that just exists in the studio. I'm just purely talking about music here. I'm not talking about the show aspect.
Okay, well, on the music, do you think computers will be able to compose music? Do you think there'll be a Turing test for music composition?
Yeah, sure.
I don't see why not either. Mm. I think it'll happen.
Yeah.
The computers will know what we like.
Mm-hmm.
Put enough randomness in there to make it interesting and produce something that is indistinguishable for the best kind of music you could imagine from a human brain.
Yeah.
It's inevitable. I think all entertainment will disappear into a computer at some point in the future. Maybe that IBM Watson one. Well, I think that about wraps it up. I can't think of anything else to talk about. I think I remain to be extremely cynical about the music industry. I think they're playing us, but they have real problems on the horizon. In fact, they have real problems now. You know, these unlimited music access subscriptions are amazing,
actually,
and surely are robbing them of huge amounts of revenue.
Yeah, we should have spoke about that a little bit more, actually, because you remember Napster and all that kind of thing?
Yes.
That started off a revolution.
It did. It did. Well, the problem that the music industry had back then, and of course they still do, is distribution. The whole distribution arm disintegrated.
Mm.
We don't care anymore. The physical media, we don't care anymore. So all of that revenue went out of the window.
Good.
Mm-hmm. Because it's all about convenience and accessibility. And you can't beat the convenience and accessibility of getting something that's pure digital without the physical manifestation. Blockbuster Video died a couple of weeks ago. Why? Well, why do you think you can stream movies or torrent movies? You know, we don't need to physically walk down to the shop. Indeed. It's a joke. But the music industry is robust enough to compensate for that. And they have these big deals with companies like Spotify and Google.
Right.
So they get, you know, quite a lot of revenue because their reach is effectively extended because being purely digital, distribution is no longer an issue. Therefore, that person in Guam, that person in China, that person wherever on the planet
can listen to your crap.
Yeah, exactly. So this has been eclecticist.co.uk. If you want more details about this podcast or would like to leave some feedback, please pop along to eclecticist.co.uk and fill out the form. You also have access to previous shows. This week, our outro music of choice is another lawsuit dodging open source track, which I thought was quite interesting, called Rainless. It's by the Sunray Ensemble. It's free. It's freely available from Last.fm. Do you remember Last.fm? They have a royalty-free sort of discover the music section in their library. It just lists loads and loads of songs that you can download for free, and they're royalty-free, which is amazing. But Sunray Ensemble is an Australian collective band, and it's at the head is a lady called Ray Howell. She's a musical director, composer, and she's really into the vibraphone, which is amazing. You have to see that. There's a link on the show notes. So have a listen to that. It's very interesting, and we will see you next time. And our topic next time, which will be very soon, is smoking and smokers. Thank you very much.